pretty clear, pretty quickly, that Ariel, Renee Jackson, and Michael J. Love would be the people that we felt the strongest about awarding this prize, because the things that we really enjoyed about it was the collaboration and just sort of the freshness of the work and how sort of the way they communicated in the collaborations that they did, but also Ariel's work specifically with sort of the point of entry. And so with that, does everyone here know these two? For those who don't, I'll give just a brief, a couple of lines from the intro, so we cover all the bases. But Ariel Renee Jackson is a Black film-based artist whose practice considers land and landscape as sites of internal representation. We have to unpack that. Mm-hmm. Themes of transformation are embedded in their interest and application of repurposed imagery and objects, video and sound and performance. Exploring how culture is inherited, Jackson modifies familial and antique farming, household and educational tools of furniture, hacking each object's purpose and meaning with nature-based material and weather-based icons. Gives you a good sort of intro.
My dissertation.
dissertation. And Michael J. Love is an interdisciplinary tap dance artist, scholar, and educator. He was recently announced as the 2021 to 2023 Princeton University Arts Fellow. Congratulations. His work embodies research, intermixes Black queer feminist theory and aesthetics with a rigorous practice and critically engages the Black cultural past as it imagines Black futurity. In Austin, his work has been supported and presented by Fusebox Festival, Art Films Dance, Ground Floor Theater, pretty much everyone in Austin. So, with that abbreviated intro, I really want to spend the time to just kind of talk about your work in general, individually, and the path that you found to collaboration that leads to this exhibition that's behind us. Ariel, can you tell me a little bit, I know your work involves video, sculpture, performance. What is the overarching theme of your work, and how does it play out across those different mediums?
Yeah, thank you everybody for coming here and celebrating the birth of our child. So I have been, over the summer, calling myself an anti-disciplinary artist, and that term is not coined by me, it's coined by my friend and fellow artist, Kiana. Talk a lot about how our practice should not be constrained to one discipline, especially if we're talking about culture, talking about diasporas. There has to be room and space for things to change. And so I've never sat well with even calling myself a film-based artist. I think that was I have to call myself something.
There's
that
a box.
Makes the
you
most
have
sense.
To fill that box.
But when Kiara was, we were just talking about how with the invention of YouTube, the way that people are experiencing art, everything's very modular, and that is our experience of making art, and it's very modular. And so when they told me that, I was like, can I borrow that? So I will always, let everybody know it's like free advertising. But yeah, I love them. So that's the best word.
Anti-disciplinary. Yeah. I resemble that remark. I think sometimes in our works as artists, we try to like invent the continuity, or maybe like honor the work we've done before by making it a part of what we're doing next. But I totally respect and understand the sort of desire and seduction of doing what needs to happen. And so, Michael, in your work, it is also, I don't know if you're an anti-disciplinarian, but your work does sort of traverse this, like, performative dance space. So how, like, tell me a little bit more about it. Like, how do your ideas fit into your dance, into your practice that way?
So I think I would label myself as interdisciplinary just because I like to think of my work as based and rooted in dance first. Because that's my training, that's my genealogy as a performance maker. But I don't know, I guess the answer to that question is that there's already so much embedded in the history of like what tap dance is and where it comes from and like who has touched it and created it and made it what it is. And so like a lot of the conversations that maybe we are having about culture and music and rhythm and what it means for like ideas to be applied. I don't know, I think we've also been talking a lot about utopia and like reaching utopia and getting to utopia and what utopia is. And for me that involves sort of like losing oneself in like repeated rhythms. That's like what tap dance is. Similar to like jazz music, yeah. Similar to like, yeah, the Holy Ghost. Yeah.
Like, catching the wave.
Like jazz, gospel, like all these like black forms of expression of music, of like tongue of swords. It's all related. So the more I try to, I don't know, maybe interdisciplinary is maybe really helpful. But I think like embodied music is like really helpful.
Yeah, and Ariel, your work deals with sort of like hacking these materials and trying to maybe go beyond what the material, the limitations of the material. And I see some of that same thing happening with dance. But where are you guys at, number two, Alpha Force, to find, to create this like, dopeness. I just I recognize that. But yeah, what are some of the origins of your collaboration? Did you naturally come to this, or was it sort of talk to me about it?
Well, we have a story. We met at UT and we met on the first day, what was supposed to be the first day of the graduate chapter of the Black Student Union, but the graduate
like the
people
black,
didn't
the
show up.
Yeah.
They didn't show up, so it was just all of us new people, black people. And, we all kind of had that chuckle, like, kind of like, ha, okay. And we got into a circle and started just asking, each other what our interest was. That was very empowering, just to like see all these different black people from different parts of the world, just all having these very different interests. And so when Michael and I, it was our turn, I think we both just kind of flagged each other like, okay, that's somebody I need to talk to. And so since then, we would rendezvous in my studio because I have like a huge studio. And so he would come over and we would trade research. And I think over time we've understood that both of us think about generational inheritance in both of our works, in terms of embodied knowledge, in terms of questioning what we've inherited, and also having some of these harder questions like respectability politics, but then navigating those and seeing sort of like, you know, cherry picking really. But also doing this kind of research where we're investigating our own roots alongside our other research of like wormholes and dance theory and all this kind of stuff. We just kind of, we both like to talk.
I can't imagine two more disparate ideas than wormholes and dance theory. But since you brought it up, let's go down this wormhole and figure some things out. As I was telling you earlier, I really like the idea of the using a wormhole as the way of sort of fleshing out these histories and identities and anthologies of stories from both your lives and how they intersect. So can we break down this installation to its basic forms? I know you interviewed both of your grandmothers separately and found some connection between the two. Let's start from there.
Is your maternal
grandmother? My paternal.
Okay. We were talking about this earlier, so Hampton University is like one of the like top HBCUs. In fact, if you get a person who went to Hampton and then who went to Howard in the room, like there might be a battle over like which one is the real HU.
HU
and it might get a little heated.
HBCU means historically black.
College
and university.
But still, I mean, still pretty. Like, I shouldn't say, like, Hampton and Howard are pretty prestigious.
Yeah.
And it's interesting. So, like, I'm learning, I'm just, like, listening to this, I'm learning, I'm just, there's a lot of, we couldn't talk about this. Like,
no, let's talk about it now. That's why we're here.
Like, the professors,
like, it's easy to walk through the exhibition and really absorb a lot of what's happening. But I think some of these conversations that are outside of the exhibition that connect to it.
I think I was just thinking about the professions of like teaching and nursing. I work with professions historically that black folks have been teaching. I think you're going to be talking
about Steve. There's also, like, my Nana talks a lot about being in an all-black neighborhood during segregation enabled the community to see themselves in these positions as nurses and teachers. And so it makes so much sense that both of our grandmothers were inspired by older siblings, by teachers, by the nurse who would come to the community and take care of everybody. And I love the fact that my Nana just gushes about how good she smells, you know. And you know, it's such an innocent thing, and for her to remember that at 5 years old. So that had me thinking, I think, you know, everybody's memory is this very different, but around 5 or 6, you start to remember things. And so I think just in hearing these conversations back, realizing that both of our grandmothers grew up in segregated neighborhoods, both of them went to Hampton University, both of them were just like inspired by, you know, being in a community where they saw themselves. And so yeah, I don't know, I'm thinking about wormholes now.
Yeah.
Because I got really interested in thinking about wormholes because I watched a documentary about wormholes. And I loved the idea of using a wormhole to go to another place in time. And then we were also talking about black futurity and sort of how do we guarantee that we are in our future, and just the whole promise of interviewing, you know, the older, the silent generation, that this is a form of archive. So the project, the ultimate point of the project, aside from the wormhole is more of a departure, but this project came out of trying to create both a practice, a system, and a project that would be an archive of itself. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and yeah, going back and interviewing your grandparents and bringing that into this present is itself a kind of traveling, time traveling. There are other things in the soil in this work. I feel like it's so potent. I mean, there's an aroma of soil as you walk into it. I have a hypersensitive sense of smell, but I felt sort of the earthiness of the soil in the work. And I know that in your previous collaboration, at least two of your previous collaborations, the soil was an important component as you, Michael, trace things through the soil. Can you talk about the significance of putting those two components together?
Well, okay. So my grandparents were farmers in rural Louisiana, and through a series of family tragedies, came to a sort of crossroads. I'm actually, going to eventually inherit my grandparents, what's left of their farmland, and that had me thinking a lot about inheritance and also about what do I pull from this into my art practice. So not like a little, how do I farm a field in the gallery, but how do I take these life hacking skills and apply it to my practice? Because neither of my grandparents on my mother's side were allowed to get an education. So seeing them get to that point of manually fixing their own tractors without an education, sort of like everything is visually reliant. And so that's been my source of inspiration in using soil, along with going to Senegal, and realizing the relationship between different locations just through how the weather patterns pick up soil and deposit elsewhere. That's how Michael and I started speaking out with each other. So you go ahead with that. You brought me the story.
There was a story of winds bringing sand from
West Africa, specifically to Houston,
Texas.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is also a site of interest for us, because in 2018 there was a whole moment where they were like, I forget which school district it was. I think it was on Sugarland. And they were building a building and they found like 95 decomposed bodies. And they could tell because of the construction of the buildings. There was like competitive hard labor, there was and they were like African American, and they belonged to African American people. And so it was like literally this race site of like sharecropping, but sharecropping comes from chattel slavery. So it was just like this idea of like the history of like our people being like sorted and being like found. But as you were talking just now, I was just thinking about like the way that tap-ins got to the US was that it came with African people who were enslaved. It was something that they were doing in their own sort of lives, right? But not only that, but like also I think it was Katrina Heather Donald, who's a dance scholar, who talks about how people like a lot of the like dance movement of like popular dances, like black popular dances, people would do like the history of those dance steps came from the way that people would like really design ways to like make the labor that they could do, so the bodies could do it. So she demonstrated in a talk, literally like the seed being dropped into the soil and being covered. So that is like this recovery movement, and that became a dance later on. So it's just like the way that this stuff is stored. And like in like and then half embody the body, but just like in ourselves and in the earth. I think we're always talking about how stuff is like always there. It's just like we laughed about the Holy Ghost a few minutes ago, but it's like that presence of like the history is like there.
Yeah, like it's all among us. I also wanted you to talk about your interest in sand, not just soil, but sand, because
Yeah, I mean, there's a tradition of tap dance of sand dancing. So there's folks like Sam and Sand and Harriet Cook Sam Brown, who are like well-known dancers who often would like, they would wear what we call leathers. So they were tap shoes, but without the taps. So it was just the leather soles on a hard surface with like a thin layer of sand, and that's how they were making the sound. So like, I think when we first met, we were talking about the soil, and I was like, oh, like sand dancing. So like, we're like, let's try it out. And it became like a, once we actually started to do it, we started in the same room, like it came and so I think we just kind of been, I think every one of our previous collaborations has involved soil in a pretty significant way.
Oh yeah, because I mean, because soil is, I mean, in this case not so much, but soil has been the stage, and typically like I'm the stage, designer in this collaboration, and then Michael disrupts that and shifts that and changes it.
Yeah.
And in return, you know, as just like a video or film artist, I'm then recapturing that. The last show we did called Descendants, I created like a few pieces that were, I guess, archiving his individual steps, but marking them out as patterns into the soil. And so there is this kind of like we're two mad scientists, kind of like creating the stage for each other. And then just like, it is what it had to be.
Yeah. And there, you know, to extend the metaphor of the soil, there's so many layers to this exhibition. Part of it, I think the thing that attracts me a lot to this exhibition installation are the stories that you're mining, the relationships between your grandparents, how you're just sort of like trying to bring this archive into the present and into the future, and the ways that you're doing that with, you know, like comics and video and sound, but you're also, I'm curious about how your alter egos, are they alter egos?
I struggle with that. I think you're fine with it being alter ego, right?
I don't know, I feel like my, so I grew up in a house with two black people. But like, my parents have this like amazing like LP collection, like original issues, like Michael, Janet, like all the like. We were really good friends in Firehouse. We were their kids' house. Like all those songs were just like country Russian, was like also someone who's like played all the time. So I always grew up with this sense of like my parents. So they would talk about. They both also went to HBCUs. So, like my mom went to Bennett Fellow, and they met in North Carolina Gantee. So like they would be like, oh, like I'm trying to use my fish fry. Like my nickname was Switch back in the day. Like I got Renee, because I was an opera. Like I was the Delta. So like I felt like I was always jealous of like that they had that experience and the tones were like on campus at that time, but was like not now, but it's like at that time, it's just it's like the way that they talk about it, it's just like wow, like I wonder, like I got the pictures of my grandparents, like that was a huge afro, my mom was like, I feel like I, and so I feel like my sort of like alter ego is like me reminiscing about like what it was like for me in my early 20s, but like also like the fully realized like theater version of myself, because like I really kind of wasn't realized yet. What it would be like to be in that time, early 70s.
You definitely have to
buy it. I feel like that's another part of it too, because it's like those are the choices that fit me well. So it's like maybe I was supposed to be born in a different era. But like also racism. So like
I was about to say, never wish that. I would say persona. Yeah, I'm still struggling with that because originally Cucucciarello was created while I was doing my undergrad studies at the Cooper Union. And so it was my first time leaving Louisiana for a long time. It was definitely a culture shock, and Cucucciarello came out of that process for me. And I kind of put it to rest when I went to a synagogue, just had a lot of things that came up for me, and I was like, I need to take a pause, take a step back, and reassess. And so now, Kimpy Charlotte is reborn as a non-binary Kim Freak, to discover the source of the blues, and is currently in residence at in Tuscaloosa.
That's,
you can Google that. I've talked about this before.
Heavy.
You can Google that.
Is there, like, so did you have any collaborations around your alter egos and personas for this work? I think you mentioned someone helping you to tease it out.
Let's talk about our other one of our collaborators who's here today, Lena Barbara Payne. She's a theater artist, theater scholar, friend, amazing person. But she really helped us sort of like geek out what, like bring these people into the room, like embody them, like what that meant.
Yeah, I'm very much indebted to Lena because I think the questions that Lena asked us was crucial for us to understand what our mission was.
Yeah.
Like, you know, to Peace Island, that they are traveling space and time, and we were kind of struggling on what our mission would be. We just knew that we both had these different, you know, persona alter egos that we had been using for some time, but didn't really, I think, understand what the core of their mission is. And so it became less about there being an event and more like how would we react? How would we respond to certain things? I think that really helped us to not think so hard about the concrete narrative and just more so think about what is our energy and how did that play out in this first collaboration.
And one of the things that with the information that you were uncovering through your conversations was this the effect that segregation, desegregation had on your grandparents and how they viewed sort of the period after that. Can you talk a little bit about that?
That came out of the conversation as a kind of, you can hear my narrative say, you know we grew up in such a big community, you know that. Like, it's sort of, it came up as a, well, this just is what it was. And
it was.
Oh, yeah, she's, both of my grandmothers are and were really great storytellers, and so I see myself as that. But you were asking about the segregated communities, and my Nana has been using a lot, and she has been, for the past, like since the pandemic started, has been talking to me about different ways that she can reach the youth, because she's like, I love what the kids are doing out there. You know, you're talking about mental health, you're talking about spirituality. That's great, but you know, the tactics are not that, you know, but she's like, I'm more concerned about what's up here and what's in here. And I think that maybe subconsciously, or maybe it's just the fact that I've been talking to her for a few years now, that topic of, you know, you are enough, and that, you know, black joy exists in the home. Things of that nature, very simple, seemingly so. But when you think about, gentrification, you think about just the legacy of how integration destroyed so many black communities, while also helping black individuals. I think the conversation keeps coming up just in terms of thinking about how can we get through this together? What can we pull from, you know, cherry pick? What can help us? Because, yeah, not everything needs to be brought back by no means, but I think there are similarities. We were just talking about earlier, there's eventually these conversations, we're wanting to publish them so that, you know, they're properly archived. And one of the conversations that we had was my Nana was telling me about how her and her classmates were able to study because they weren't allowed to be in the same classroom as white people. And so they basically set up an analog version of YouTube by recording themselves doing all the activities they would learn from an instructor so that they could come in between work or on their own schedules and teach themselves so that they could pass the requirements to then take the classes at the white university. So in a sense, they hacked together their own education because they had to.
Yeah, which a lot of people, what is the saying? Necessity is the mother of invention. This exhibition is so rich, and I want everyone to get an opportunity to check it out before it leaves. I don't want to end the conversation without two things. First, asking you something related to the Tito's Pride, but also leaving room for people in the audience to ask you a couple of questions. It's a pretty, somewhat significant award, the Tito's Prize, not only the opportunity to have this exhibition, but a stipend that sort of funds the furthering of your work. Can you talk about the prize? And nobody put me up to this, by the way. I'm just like personally curious about how getting a prize, because one of the things that we talked about in our conversation about awarding the prize is like, how will the artist use the prize to further their work? And do we award it to someone that is sort of already just sort of like in the stratosphere, or do we award it to someone that is sort of like focused on developing the things that they're currently working on? So I'm just curious about how the prize has affected the things that are coming up in here.
I mean, very practically, we split down the middle. So I'm all over this stuff. And like some of the, like we sat down and made like a big spreadsheet budget. And like some of the prize helped pay for my move, so I could like take this scholarship against it. So that's literally like allowed me to like continue my life in that stuff in a real practical way.
Yeah.
And like, it was like mid-COVID. I think we're still mid-COVID, but it was like early in the pandemic for like money was like a little bit more money as a artist or something. So like they paid rent. Right? So I did like those things as well as like allowed us to like buy the equipment, pay for the space for the film to happen.
Yeah, I mean, I do feel like we're incredibly blessed because we were just helped by so many other organizations like Ground Floor and NOHAS. That's not here now, but they were as crucial as anything. But what was really great for me is the fact that we could collaborate with people. I am a jack of all trades, but I'm also like, I realize the importance of being able to delegate in order to realize an idea, because some ideas need more support in the sense that there are different components moving for this. And so being able to document everything, we were able to work with Cindy Elizabeth, and that was amazing because she's talented, comes in, leaves without a trace. And working with Yumina, I think those elements is what the prize helped us really get. That along with equipment, like we can do this again now.
Yeah.
That's amazing. The fact that I could buy that much material and really, I always wanted to make sets of that.
Yeah.
I just never had enough material or enough space.
Yeah.
So it really was incredible to be able to get that much material and that much support. Oh, there's Zach, one of our what is it? Gratuitous? No.
Gracious
host that allowed me to take up space at MOHA to build these walls. And it's just I really envision our collaboration to expand to almost like this quasi theater, fine arts production.
Yeah.
You know, of bringing different skills together and realizing it. And so it's really nice to see in the pamphlets just so many other names than ours. It kind of takes off the pressure too.
I think awards like this allow you to like actionize your community and not like out of your community. So it's I think that's also important to mark that I know what artist is just working with that. You know? I mean, I guess some of them. I feel like good art happens because like you have people you can call on. So like, I feel like this award is like so fun for me.
Hey,
I can write you a check.
Hey,
okay.
Can I pay you? Like,
I'll
hang out
and like do the thing
you?
That you do well.
Yeah.
We can do it together, and then like also be with research. Like,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
You pay.
Yeah.
Yeah. I get it. We're going with Jackson, Michael, Dana. Thank you for taking the time to chat about your work. I would like to open the floor to anyone that has questions about the exhibition or about the artist's work in the room.
I'm all speaking.
So the comic strip, shout out to Gary James Marshall. The comic strips come out of an opportunity I had to participate in a publication. And when we were working with Unino, initially we had a script that we wanted to have, and we realized we are not actors. And so what the comic strip allowed us to do was to set a sort of a context for what the installation is. And it also reveals a little bit more of the text that's outside of what you hear here. So eventually, this installation, the comic strip, and the book will kind of function as an archive in and of itself, like it's archiving and referencing each other.
I feel like that demonstrates anti-disciplinary, right? Because it's like, not only are you getting this like physical manifestation of a set, you're getting like video, you're getting sound, you're getting text, you're getting illustration, so it's like all these ways that we're thinking about the same thing, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think my practice has been varied when it comes to the aesthetics of things, but I do see each show or each project as a body of work, because there's always a physical element, there's always a documentary aspect, more so going forward, there's a research aspect, and so it's I've found that it's a lot easier for me to create a space rather than a series or a body of work, so I consider something like this our body of work, because Avion helped us build. Yes.
Hi guys.
And troubleshoot. Yes.
Well, thank you both again so much, and thank you all for coming.